We don't have those usually in the villages either. It's been a blessing. Since the video was made, obviously there's been a few changes, which I'm very grateful for. I started my deputation. I've spent about a year and a half on deputation, and about halfway through that, the Lord gave me my wife, Victoria, and I'm so thankful for that, as this is a ministry that I was praying that the Lord didn't want me to do alone. And I had made the video before we got married, before I even met Victoria, and she watched it, and you know the part it says pray about and ask the Lord if he'd have you to be a part of this ministry? Well, she prayed, and the Lord said yes, so I'm thankful for that. But she was saved at a young age and felt called to by the Lord to serve as in missions someday. So I'm grateful. Also, we have our first child due coming up next month. So the ministry team is growing, and we're thankful for that. The video mentioned two mission works that the Lord had allowed us to start. Those have been combined into one. They were close enough together, and my brother has taken over that church that mission work, I should say, as pastor, trying to bring that church up to the next stage. And my dad has moved on to another town in northern Canada called Terrace. Terrace has about 13,000 folks, no fundamental church. They had an independent Baptist church up until about 5 years ago, and due to some sad circumstances, it's no longer in existence. So Dad has felt led to go work there. For my wife and I, when we get up there, there's a group of villages called the Nisga Nation. The Nisga Nation is part of the Nisga tribe of Indians in northern Canada. And this group of villages, there's about six villages totaling about 4,500 people, close to 5,000. And there isn't a single church there right now holding regular services. Not just a church of our kind, not just a Baptist church, but no church at all. They had an Anglican church and their priest passed away. And I was talking to my dad recently on the phone. He said, I don't believe there's a single church right now holding services there in those villages. So it's wide open. There's needs all over, everywhere you look, but the Lord has called us to go and work. We would like to focus on those villages when we get up there. And then the Lord has really burdened our hearts for the remote villages that you couldn't get to. As mentioned in the video, 80% of your towns in Alaska, there's no way to get there by road, even the capital city. And you know, having gone there, that some places you can literally say you just can't get there from here. It's just very difficult. A pastor friend of mine called me recently, and he asked me, how hard would it be to get to Wrangell? He said, I know some folks in Wrangell. I'm going to be in Alaska. And I had to explain to him that's 1,000 miles away, that there's no flights to go to Wrangell from where he was going. And it would take him days and days and thousands of dollars to get there. He said, that's not what I wanted to hear. But it's just part of being in Alaska. I was looking at a map recently, and there's villages in Alaska. I was raised in the southeast part of the state, as far south and as far east in the state as you can get. Other parts of Alaska call it the banana belt. It's not quite that, but it's south for Alaska. But there's villages in Alaska that are farther away from where I live in Hyder than Austin, Texas. Meaning, Austin, Texas is about 3,300 miles from where I grew up, but there's villages 4,800 miles from where I live, also in Alaska. So Alaska is so spread out. You have villages all across the state. And because they're so hard to get in, they're so hard to work in, you've had missionaries in parts of the state, and I'm thankful, but oftentimes they're stuck in their village without any ability to reach even nearby villages. Even villages that are only 20, 30, maybe 50 miles away, they're just so hard to get to. And so the Lord has burdened our heart to work in these villages. We'd love to hit them all. The group that the Lord has put on our hearts is in southeast Alaska, both on the Canadian side and the Alaska side of the border. There's the same tribes, just split by a border. They actually have free access. They can travel back and forth without borders and things like that. But the doors are open for working in these villages. And there's about three dozen that we'd like to work in on the Alaska side, a few more on the Canadian side. But we've been praying for an airplane, praying that God would provide miraculously. When I went through flight school, I said, Dad, how in the world am I just going to pay for flight school? He said, if the Lord wants you to do it, He'll provide. And I watched the Lord open so many doors, and I don't have time to share them all, but it was amazing to see how God opened the doors for me to get my pilot's license. And now, the exciting news that the pastor was mentioning is that we've been praying for this airplane for a couple years. Well, about 3 months ago, maybe four now, I was contacted by a friend of mine he's an elderly missionary. He's served in Papua New Guinea for about 48 years. He's had to come off the field. His health is still good, but his wife is very bad in her health, so he's had to come back off the field. And due to the situation in Papua New Guinea, with the fuel and the government regulations, the red tape, really, the government has shut down really almost all private operations of small airplanes. It's just a complicated issue. You wouldn't think that with being a third world country, but it's just almost impossible to fly those small planes over there right now. And so this missionary, Brother Bloom, he used a plane in Papua New Guinea for quite a number of years. He said right now it's sitting there. He said it's in the village. He said it's not being used. It won't be used in the foreseeable future. He said, and I can't afford to get it back to the States. He said, but if your ministry can get it back to the States, y'all can have the airplane. And so that is a huge answer to prayer. That's something only God could do. That plane sitting at the local airport, if it was for sale, would be worth probably around $100,000. And so that is a huge answer to prayer. And we're just, some things are happening and working, and we're looking at, Lord willing, if He allows us to fly over there, myself anyways, to fly over there in April, take the wings off of it, put it in a container, and ship it back, as the Lord would allow us to do that. And so some exciting things going on, but I believe that the Lord wants these villages reached. And there's needs everywhere. I was in a missions conference, and the missionary that presented before me was going to Mexico City, one of the, if not the largest city in the world. And there's great needs down there. And I was just thinking, it's interesting that the Lord would call someone to go to the biggest city in the world and then me to some of the smallest villages in the world. And yet, the Lord reminded me that when He was on earth and He was ministering to thousands of people around the Sea of Galilee, He told His disciples to get in a boat. They crossed over the sea and they got to talk to one man, a maniac. And you would have to think that the disciples, I mean, they went through storm and tempest and the darkness, and then they get over there and they just talk to one guy. And you'd think that the disciples had to, in their human way of thinking, had to think that maybe Jesus, maybe He missed it this time. Maybe that wasn't such a good idea. But the Lord knew what He was doing. He had the burden for the thousands and the multitudes, but then He knew there was one man across the sea that needed to hear. And He went over there to talk to him. And so I'm thankful for everywhere that God has sent missionaries. There's needs all over the world. But I know for us, it's the villages up in Canada and Alaska. Appreciate you if you'd pray for us as we go. We're at 75% of our support, looking to be finished by springtime, as the Lord would bless. Hebrews chapter 11, we'll begin reading here and looking into this lesson this evening from the life of Moses. I love studying the lives of these people that are mentioned in this passage, but one of my favorites is Moses. I love to study his life. We'll begin reading in verse 24 of Hebrews chapter number 11. It says, by faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith, he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this day and for this opportunity we have to gather in your house, to hear the songs, everything that is. Lord, I pray that you would bless the reading of your word and the message that it goes forth. Lord, I pray that you'd speak to our hearts, that it be an encouragement. And Lord, that we'd, as Moses, be faithful to you. Lord, we love you and ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Moses was a man that it is very apparent that God was preparing him from an early age, before he was born really, to do something. That God had a plan for Moses. God had something he wanted Moses to do. And you might ask, what was God wanting Moses to do? What was the main purpose that God had for Moses? The easy answer, the one that I would give naturally, would be that God wanted Moses to bring the children of Israel from Egypt and into the promised land. That was the overriding picture. That's what God wanted Moses to do. And that is, of course, true. But I believe that the purpose of God for Moses went beyond just physically bringing the children of Israel out of Egypt. I believe, you know, the Bible says the heart of the king is in the hand of the Lord. So firstly, I don't believe that God had to have Moses. That the Lord was in heaven wondering what he was going to do until Moses came along. Of course, that was not the case. God in his grace has decided, and even you could say limited himself to using us. Perhaps you could say that God's glory is more shown in the fact that he uses man in his inability instead of doing it personally himself. The glory of God is more clearly seen because God chooses to use us. And God wanted to use Moses. God had a plan for Moses' life, but God could have got the children of Israel out of Egypt without Moses. There was a time in the history of the nation of Israel when the children of Israel again were exiled in another land. They were in Babylon, the Syrians, the Medes and the Persians, and you know the story how the children of Israel had rebelled and they'd gone into captivity for 70 years. But when the time came for the children of Israel to go back, God didn't use a Moses this time. God raised up the king. King Cyrus, God put in a king who it came into his heart and he made a decree and sent them back. The Bible says the heart of the king is in the hand of the Lord. The Lord could have done that with the children of Israel in Egypt. The Lord could have changed Pharaoh's heart, or if Pharaoh hardened his heart, God could have put in a king who would do his will and send them back. But instead, God used Moses. And I'd like to look at what was his purpose? I believe it was more than just physically bringing them out of Egypt, but more importantly, if you would turn back to the book of Exodus, and we'll be going between Exodus and the book of Hebrews a little bit this evening. But I believe that God's purpose was more than just to bring them out of Egypt. If you'll look in Exodus chapter 3 and verse number 13. This is getting ahead in the story, but you find something interesting. What Moses says in verse 13, it says, "And Moses said unto God, Behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, The God of your fathers has sent me unto you. And they shall say to me, What is his name? What shall I say unto them?" Of course, in verse 14, "And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am hath sent me unto you." You know, at this time in Israel, they didn't have a Bible like we have today. They didn't have a written word of God. What they knew of God is what they had heard from their fathers, as what God had done for Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, and those stories and traditions had been passed down generation to generation. But in the meantime, you find that they say, "The God of your fathers." To these people, they had heard of what God had done for their fathers. They had heard of how God brought Joseph into Egypt and he saved him from the famine. And he'd heard of all these things. But to the children of Israel at this time, he was the God of their fathers. And God wasn't satisfied just to be the God of their fathers. God wanted to be their God personally. That he wanted them to know who he was in a personal way. And I believe that the purpose of God for Moses, more than just bringing them out of Egypt, was to bring them unto himself. That they as a people would learn who he is. That they would learn his name and develop a relationship with God for themselves. God wanted his people to know who he is. If you look in chapter 6, in verse 6, God says this as much. And he says, in verse 6, "I am the Lord, and I will bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians." Verse 7, "I will take you to me for a people, and I will be to you a God, and ye shall know that I am the Lord your God." God said that the purpose of what he was doing, why he was sending Moses, why the plagues, why all these things, was that the children of Israel would learn who he is and have that relationship. "I will be to you a God, and ye shall know that I am the Lord your God." God wanted his people to know who he is. But it's interesting to note it didn't stop there. God wasn't just satisfied with his people knowing who he is. You know, at this time in history, God's main focus was on his chosen people, the nation of Israel, the children of Israel. And yet, in Exodus chapter 7 and verse 5, you find that God wanted others to know as well. It says in verse 5 of Exodus 7, "And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord." God didn't just want His people to know. He also wanted the nations. He wanted, here it says Egypt, "that Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord." God at this time wanted the Egyptians to know. If you look ahead in Exodus 9, you think of the character in the story, the antagonist, you might say, of the story is Pharaoh, of course. He is the one who hardened his heart. But you know, when Moses went to Pharaoh the first time, when God sent Moses and he went before Pharaoh, do you know what? When Moses said to Pharaoh, "The God of the children of Israel sent me unto you, saying, 'Let my people go.'" Do you know what Pharaoh said at that time? He said, "Who is the Lord that I should obey His voice?" He said, "I know not the Lord, neither will I let the people go." Who knows, but perhaps he might have been telling the truth here. Perhaps he was being honest and saying, "I don't know who you're talking about." And yet later on, as you see God working and God using the plagues and using Moses, at the end of Pharaoh's life, he couldn't say, "Who is the Lord?" God wanted Pharaoh to know who He is. You see this in Exodus 9 and verse 14. It says, "For I will at this time send all my plagues upon thine heart and upon thy servants and upon thy people, that thou mayest know that there is none like me in all the earth." God wanted Pharaoh to know. And God knew Pharaoh would harden his heart. But God still wanted him to know. And lastly, you see in verse 16 that God's focus was not just on Moses or the children of Israel or Pharaoh or Egypt, but it says in the end of verse 16, "that my name may be declared throughout all the earth." God wanted to use Moses and to use these circumstances that he was doing that all the earth would know, "that my name may be declared throughout all the earth." It's interesting, at this time God wanted the whole world to know who He is. Of course, who has not heard of Moses and who has today not heard of what God did with Moses? But I would like to look, did this happen even back in that day? Did all the earth hear? If you would quickly turn ahead to the book of Joshua, you'll find something interesting in chapter 2. The book of Joshua chapter 2. I've wondered sometimes, why did God have Joshua send 2 spies to go and spy out the city of Jericho? God had told Joshua that the city was going to be destroyed, and the Lord didn't need to know what was inside Jericho. And yet, He sent these 2 spies through Joshua, and I believe the reason was that God had something in mind more than just spying out the land. If you'll look here, we don't have time to get into the story, but they, of course, were in the city, and they went into the house of Rahab. And in verse 9, you see something that Rahab says. Now we're looking at, God said that He wanted all the earth to know through what He was doing. Well, look in verse 9 of Joshua chapter 2. It says, "And she said unto the men," this is Rahab speaking to the spies, "I know that the Lord hath given you the land." And you might pause and wonder, what does she know about the Lord? This is a Canaanite heathen woman in a heathen city that's about to be destroyed. And yet she is telling the spies, "I know that the Lord hath given you the land, and that your terror has fallen upon us." Look in the next verse. Verse 10, it says, "For we have heard." God said that He wanted His name to be declared throughout all the earth because of how He was using Moses and how He was doing all these things. And now a little over 40 years later, there's a woman in this city of Jericho that's saying, "We have all heard what your God did." Then what was the difference? How comes that only she was saved? Well, notice in verse 11, at the end of the verse, she gives her statement of faith. All had heard, but she put her faith in what she had heard. It says in verse 11, "For the Lord your God, He is God in heaven above and in the earth beneath." And God saw a woman that had put her faith in what she heard, and God sent salvation right to her door. God's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And God used Moses in a miraculous way, way beyond himself, that Israel would learn who He is. That Israel would have a relationship with God. That the Egyptians would learn. That Pharaoh even would learn. But then that the story of God and what He had done would go throughout all the world. And this heathen Gentile woman would hear and put her faith in what she heard. And you know, we looked in Hebrews chapter 11. We looked at Moses, and it says, by faith, Moses. But you know, the next person mentioned in that chapter is this woman, Rahab. That's the grace of God. That's God's grace, as God would save and bring out this woman from destruction. You know, later in the book, she's without the camp. Her family is brought out from Jericho, but they're outside. But later, there's a Jewish man named Salmon, and he goes and he marries this girl. And they together have a son named Boaz. And you may wonder, why did Boaz go out of his way to befriend and marry the Moabite Ruth? Because he had seen what God had done in grace and mercy for his mother. And later, their descendants is Jesus Christ himself. That's the grace of God. But you see that God was doing something more than just bringing the children of Israel out of Egypt, but teaching them who he was. Just in closing, I'd like to look at three reasons why God could use Moses. We see that God was using Moses. He had a plan for Moses' life. But Moses had to be willing. Moses had to surrender and allow God to use him. In Hebrews chapter 11, it says, by faith Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. As Moses comes to a time in his life where he has to make a decision, he's got all the world has to offer at his fingertips. He's got it. He's got it made, you might say. And yet he comes to a time in his life, he's 40 years old, and he's got to make a decision. Was he going to follow the world, pictured by Egypt, and all that the world had to offer? And humanly speaking, the world could give him a lot. Egypt could have given him everything. But he had to make a decision. Is he going to follow Egypt, or is he going to follow God? And I believe his decision is summed up in verse 27. It says, by faith, he forsook Egypt. By faith, Moses came to the point in his life where he had to make a decision. He's got the world on one hand, and he's got to follow God on the other hand. And by faith, this decision can only be made by faith, because through worldly eyes you would never see the value. But by faith, he decided to forsake Egypt, to turn his back on all that was Egypt, all that he had, and he decided to follow God. I believe the first reason that Moses could be used of God was he was willing to separate himself unto God, to turn his back on all that the world had to offer and say, by faith, I'm going to follow God no matter what it costs me. I believe that's the first reason why God could use Moses. After this is when God begins to work in Moses' life in a great way, but he had to make that decision. And we've all heard the song in Sunday school, the world behind me, the cross before me. I've decided to follow Jesus. But you know, there comes a time when you're really going to have to make that decision. It's going to have to be more than just a song you learned in Sunday school. You have to make that decision that come what may, I've decided to follow Jesus. And Moses made that decision. By faith, he forsook Egypt. Secondly, not only was he willing to separate himself unto God and to turn his back on Egypt, but I believe Moses learned an important lesson that if we never learned, that God can't use us like he wants to. If you would look back in the book of Acts, chapter 7, you find in the preaching of Stephen something more about Moses. In Acts chapter 7, in verse 22, it says, Moses was learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptians and was mighty in words and in deeds. Acts 7 and verse 23. And when he was full 40 years old, it came into his heart to visit his brethren, the children of Israel. And seeing one of them suffer wrong, he defended him and avenged him that was oppressed and smote the Egyptian. You know, God had Moses had made the decision he's going to follow God. At this point, he's the die was cast. He's turned his back on the world, spiritually, so to speak, and physically quite soon. He's decided he's going to associate with the God of his people. And now, it's clear that Moses believes at this point that God has a plan for his life. And he was right. God wanted to use him. Here, in the next verse, you find the thinking of Moses. What was Moses thinking? What was he doing? Was this just an act of passion as he sees this and he just can't contain himself and he goes and delivers this slave and kills this Egyptian taskmaster? This was a calculated move on Moses' part. Moses had a plan. Notice in verse 25, it says, "For he supposed his brethren would have understood how that God by his hand would deliver them, but they understood not." He believes at this point that it is God's will for him to bring the children of Israel out of Egypt. He believes he knows God's will for his life. The problem is he believes that he's up to it in his own strength, and he goes about to do God's will, but in his own strength, in his own abilities, in his own efforts, and he fails miserably. He falls flat on his face as he goes, and he believes that when he delivers this slave that the children of Israel are going to rally behind him and he's going to be their deliverer. He's going to bring them out of Egypt. We know that was not the case, and instead he had to flee for his life. But such will be the result of any of us if we begin to try to do God's will in our own methods and in our own abilities, in our own strength. Moses, it says he was mighty in word and deed. He's 40 years old. He believes he's ready. He's going to serve God. And now he says, "Let's do this." And he begins to try to do it. It was another 40 years went by. In Exodus, we'll end in Exodus this evening, Exodus chapter 3. 40 years go by. As he's failed, 40 years go by of God teaching Moses something about himself, both about God and about Moses. But in Exodus chapter 3, 40 years have gone by. Moses is 80 years old, and God speaks to him in verse 10. It says, "Come now, therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt." What is different this time? This is what Moses believed God wanted him to do 40 years ago. The difference is with Moses in verse 11. "And Moses said unto God, Who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh?" At this time, Moses is 80 years old, and this time he says, "Lord, I can't do that." He says, "Lord," verse 11, "Who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh?" He basically says, "I can't do that. That's beyond my abilities." And you could say that God could look down at Moses at that point and say that he was ready. And this was the time, this was where God wanted Moses to be. Moses had to realize that he could not do it. God knew Moses couldn't do it. Only God could do it through Moses. And that's what the Lord says in verse number 12. It says, "And he said," the Lord speaking to Moses says, "Certainly I will be with thee." The Lord knew Moses couldn't do it. Moses had to get to the place where he was at the end of himself and relying only on God, relying on the Lord to do what Moses could not do. Moses learned that he couldn't do it in his own strength. And lastly, I believe there's another reason why the Lord could use Moses. It's in chapter 4 and verse number 2. You know, Moses learned so much to rely on the presence of God. He learned so much, he knew he couldn't do it. He relied so much on God that down the road, later when the children of Israel had rebelled and had turned their back on God, there's a time when God told the children of Israel, he said, "Go into the promised land. Take the children of Israel and go into the promised land." But God said, "But I will not go up in the midst of thee." Basically, God said because of the rebellion of the people, Moses could bring them into the promised land, but God could not go with them because of their rebellion. And you know what Moses said at this point? Moses is way past the days where he thinks he can do it in his own strength. Moses says to God, "If thy presence go not with us, carry us not up hence." He says, "Lord, basically, if you're not going, then I'd rather stay in the wilderness if I can have your presence than to go into the promised land to look successful, to look like I've done what I was supposed to do, but to be doing it by myself." Moses learned that he couldn't do it in his own strength. And then in Exodus chapter 4 and verse 2, it says, "And God said unto him, What is that in thine hand? And he said, A rod." Moses at this time was a shepherd. He'd been a shepherd for 40 years, it seems. And it's the most ordinary thing in the world for a shepherd to carry a stick or a staff or a rod. Christmas time is getting closer. And you never see a shepherd in the manger scenes. You always see a shepherd and he's got something in his hand. It's one of those rods. It's something quite ordinary, just a stick he might have whittled as he walked around in the desert. But this was something ordinary something insignificant. And perhaps even when God asked Moses, what's in your hand, Moses had to stop and think for a second. But this was, I want you to understand, something ordinary, not something extraordinary, not something spectacular, just a stick, just a rod. But notice what God told Moses to do with it. In verse 3, and he said, cast it on the ground, symbolizing that God had Moses had something in his hand that God wanted him to let go of. God wanted him to surrender this thing to God. Perhaps Moses could have been looking at this as a support or perhaps protection. Or we don't know exactly what significance the rod had to Moses, but in any case, God told him to cast it on the ground. And when Moses cast that rod on the ground, something happened to that rod. Yes, of course, it became a snake and all those things, but something more importantly than that, in the book, in Exodus chapter 4 and verse 20, you find what happened to that rod. It says, and Moses, in the end of the verse, Moses took the rod of God in his hand. I believe that when Moses let go of that rod, that the possession, the ownership of that rod changed. That rod became God's rod. Moses, when he went back to Egypt with God's rod. And that was a whole lot better than if Moses had tried to go back to Egypt with his own rod. You know, that oftentimes for us as believers, we have something we're holding on to, something that we want to keep for ourselves, but God wants us to give it to Him. And God can do a whole lot more with it than we can. Imagine if Moses was standing before the Red Sea and it's there and they got mountains on either side and the Egyptian army behind him and Moses has his own rod. I wouldn't have wanted to have been in that position. But Moses has the rod of God in his hand, and God tells him to stretch it out forth over that water, and God parted the water. But God was using Moses because Moses was yielded to him, and God was using the things he had in his hand because they were yielded to him. God wants us to be yielded to him. He wants the things in our hands to be yielded to him. And God will do a lot more with them than we can. I believe that God could use Moses because he was yielded himself to God and yielded the things he had in his hand. And God could do a lot more with it. You know, you think of times in the Bible where God did things for people. And oftentimes, he used insignificant people with insignificant tools or insignificant things in their hands. He used David with just a slingshot and a couple stones. You think in the New Testament of the little lad that had the little lunch with just a few loaves and a few fish, but God used it to feed a multitude. But because the lad was willing to yield it to God. And for us in our lives, not only must we come to the place where we turn our back on Egypt and surrender ourselves to God, not only must we realize that we can't do it in our own strength, but God wants us to yield ourselves to Him. The things that He has put in our hands, He wants us to yield that to Him as well. And God will use our life for the purpose He has for it. God's purpose for us, as it was for Moses, was that God's testimony, that His glory be shown, that God wants to use us as He used Moses, not to bring the children of Israel out of Egypt, but more importantly, to be a testimony and a witness and a light that God's name would go forth and that others would learn of the glory of the Lord that we serve. But we'll have to get to the point as Moses and surrender and yield and say, Lord, use me. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank You for this day. Thank You for the lesson that You've given us from the life of Moses. Lord, how You used his life. As many faults as he had, You used him. And Lord, we pray that You'd use us, that You'd help us to be faithful and yielded, and through the eyes of faith to see it's more valuable to serve You than any other thing. Lord, we love You. Thank You for this church, and this time to be here today. In Jesus' name, amen.